say.
I'm very pleased and honored today to be having with us, to be welcoming Mr. Anthony Blinken, Secretary of State of the U.S. I'd like to extend a warm welcome to him to Morocco. We are all pleased and glad to meet him in our the first official state meeting of Secretary of State in the current administration to Morocco. Welcome to you, sir. As per the vision of His Majesty King Mohammed VI, the Moroccan-U.S. relations have always been long-standing and based on long-standing partnership that's quite ambitious and developed, also grounded on personal relation between His Majesty King Mohammed VI and President Joe Biden since their meeting in Marrakesh back in 2016. With Mr. Secretary of State, we met yesterday in Negev in Israel to talk about how to support positive dynamics in the Middle East. We are convening today also today as part of our endeavor to further strengthen our relations. In May, we'll convene again as part of the global alliance and coalition against ISIS and to support our joint endeavors to fight extremism and terrorism worldwide. In June, Morocco and the U.S. will hold African line maneuvers. That's one of the major parts of our military cooperation. In July, we will also host the Economic American African Forum in Marrakesh. All this testifies to the richness of our U.S. and Moroccan relations. Thanks to their variety and diversity, this covers the political side, the security side, the military side, the economic side. This is a partnership that goes beyond our bilateral relations to cover other areas like the Middle East, Africa, and other parts of the world. Our relations are strong. Our partnership is strong, grounded on mutual shared values, shared interests, grounded also on shared vision around a number of international issues and regional issues. His Majesty the King wants to make sure that these relations move forward as part of the tools and mechanisms that we all have. The strategic dialogue, and we held 2 weeks ago a round with Lady Wendy Sherman. Also dialogue on human rights, and we held two rounds earlier. The FTA, that is the only U.S. agreement with an African country, which has resulted in very positive outcomes in terms of developing and promoting our trade relations. And we hope this will also play a key role in moving forward with the U.S. investments in Morocco. As part of the MCC also, which has been a contribution, an important contribution to the endeavor of Morocco, and also as part of tools for security and military cooperation. This cooperation has always been strong and very productive, resulting in many initiatives between the U.S. and Morocco. Today, we have talked around all these issues and how to further develop our mutual relations and bilateral relations, so this partnership can be strong and modeled based on historical values and also in line with the current ambitions and values. We have talked about the different challenges in Middle East, and we would like to thank the U.S. as a party to the three-party agreement signed before His Majesty back in December 2022, where Morocco has relaunched its relations with Israel. This agreement has resulted in positive outcomes, and this can also yield more fruits as part of concrete projects that are beneficial to the Moroccan and Israeli peoples. But the three-party agreement, Israel, U.S. and Morocco, is also a message and a sign for the need of a two-state solution, steady solution in the Middle East by setting up a free state with Jerusalem East as a capital, living and coexisting with Israel. And as part of the vision of His Majesty the King, Jerusalem can be a city for coexistence. We have talked also about our partnership in Africa to face up to the different challenges, but also to make profit of the many opportunities we have in Africa, economically, in terms of trade, and also in terms of climate changes, and also in the area of trade and infrastructures, and also in terms of security and healthcare and military. Africa is fertile land for U.S.-Moroccan cooperation. And also the North Africa and Sahel, there are many challenges, there are many tensions that have to be addressed, and also there are many security-related challenges that need to be addressed positively and constructively. I think your visit, Antony, is very important, and that has produced clear messages about this cooperation, the many possibilities we can actually profit from here to the benefit of our two countries, but also to the benefit of security and stability and development in areas that we consider to be very important to us and to you. Once again, thank you for your visit, and you are most welcome.
Foreign Minister Nasser, thank you. It's really good to be with you once again. It feels like it was only yesterday. Indeed, we just came from the historic Negev Summit, and together with our partners from Bahrain, from Egypt, the United Arab Emirates, and Israel, we discussed, as Nasser said, a wide range of areas where we can seize on normalization to make a positive impact on the lives of our people. It's an effort that quite simply would not have been possible were it not for the courage and vision of leaders like His Majesty King Mohammed VI to break down longstanding barriers. And I'm committed to working with the Foreign Minister and all our friends here and across the region to make this vision real, translating it into more opportunities for people and further widening the circle of friendship. Now, while integration among some of these countries is new, the diplomatic relationship between Morocco and the United States dates back more than 240 years. And its depth and breadth are reflected in everything we discussed today. And Nasser touched on a lot of these issues. For more than 15 years, our free trade agreement has benefited people and companies in both of our countries and beyond. Today, we discussed how we can continue to grow our economic cooperation, in particular, to benefit underserved populations. For example, we're in the fifth and final year of what is a $460 million compact administrated by the U.S. Millennium Challenge Corporation. That's provided jobs and education opportunities for young people, boosted agricultural productivity, expanded land rights for women. The compact includes a partnership with Morocco's Ministry of Education that is piloting a model aimed at improving secondary education in 90 secondary schools across the country, training some 6,000 teachers and administrators, making investments in the school's infrastructure and in its technology. Just last week, our officials came together and broke ground on a major expansion of the industrial zone in Buznica, backed by a public-private partnership, and that is expected to generate some 4,000 jobs. Partners show up for each other in difficult times. And as Morocco experiences one of the worst droughts in decades, we're doing what we can to help. Now, I tried to do what I could to help by bringing a little rain with me today, but that's clearly not enough. We have experts from the State Department, the Department of the Interior, consulting directly with their Moroccan counterparts on immediate steps to diminish the drought's impact and to increase water conservation. Tomorrow, we're hosting a conference in Casablanca that will bring together your top water management companies with some experts in the United States to focus on how this country can better produce, use, and conserve its water resources. And going back long before this drought, we've been working to build greater capacity in the country to try to predict, prepare for, and mitigate the worst impacts of droughts, and to train rising generations of Moroccan water management experts. The droughts already affected agricultural production, we know, raising the cost of food. Now, the natural disaster is being worsened by a man-made disaster, as the Russian government and its brutal war in Ukraine has disrupted the supply of wheat and other commodities. Here, across the region, we're discussing concrete steps we can take and our partners can take to help reduce the impact of these shortages, particularly on the most vulnerable populations. This disruption is another reason we'll continue to urge our friends and partners to speak out with one voice in condemning the Russian government's aggression, the consequences of which are being felt around the world, and hold the Kremlin accountable for as long as this continues. The increasing frequency and severity of droughts and other extreme weather here in the United States, around the world, also underscores the urgency of our collective efforts to address the climate crisis. And in this, Morocco is a world leader, setting an ambitious target of achieving 63% renewable energy by 2035. With 45% of the country's electricity production already coming from renewables, Morocco is on track to meet this ambitious target and even exceed it. Morocco also signed the Global Methane Pledge at COP26. And at COP22, the kingdom founded three African-wide commissions, the Congo Basin Commission, the Sahel Commission, the Small Island Nations Commission, and continues to lead climate finance and feasibility studies for all three of them. We've also worked side by side in combating the COVID-19 pandemic. We've been able to donate more than 2.5 million safe, effective vaccines to Morocco through the COVAX initiative over the last several months alone. And since the outset of the pandemic, we've been working closely with the Moroccan Ministry of Health and other partners to train health workers, provide PPE and essential lab equipment, and enhance Morocco's vaccine cold chain, all of which has helped contribute to a very effective response led by His Majesty to COVID here in Morocco. And Morocco is also now contributing to the efforts that other countries make, something we greatly appreciate. We launched a $3 million partnership with the Pasteur Institute of Morocco to strengthen global health security capacity so that we can prepare for, respond to, and deal with infectious disease in the future. We support King Mohammed VI's ambitious reform agenda to strengthen Morocco's institutions and ensure government is responsive to the Moroccan people. The United States is committed to working with Morocco to make concrete progress in key areas, advancing the right to freedom of expression and association, criminal justice reforms, women's rights and gender equality, government transparency, which the foreign minister and I had an opportunity to discuss today. We also discussed security. The United States recognizes the important role that Morocco plays in maintaining regional security and stability, as well as its contribution to peace and prosperity in the region. We're collaborating closely on addressing regional issues like the Sahel and Libya, the fight against terrorism, where Morocco has demonstrated sustained leadership through the Global Counterterrorism Forum and the Global Terrorism Coalition to Defeat ISIS. We very much support the work of the United Nations personal envoy of the Secretary General, Stéphane de Mistura, in leading the political process for Western Sahara under the auspices of the United Nations to promote a peaceful and prosperous future for the people of Western Sahara and the region. And we appreciate Morocco's support for this mission. We continue to view Morocco's autonomy plan as serious, credible, and realistic, and one potential approach to meet the aspirations of the people of Western Sahara. Let me just conclude by wishing an early Ramadan Kareem to the people of Morocco and around the world who will celebrate the holy month starting in just a few days. And I wish our Moroccan friends, I shouldn't say this, I'm going to wish you good luck in the World Cup qualifying match. That's not fair to the other side. If we wish both sides good luck, it will wind up in a tie, but that's good for Morocco. So, Nasser, thank you for hosting us. Thank you for your leadership. Thank you for your friendship.
Now, questions for the press. We'll take the first one from Vedoum Rabdi, Lat TV.
Good afternoon, Fadoum Rabti from Al Ghad Channel. His Majesty Mohammed VI is the president of Al Quds Committee, and Morocco has been playing historical roles in terms of the Palestinian cause today after resuming relations with Israel. How does the U.S. administration see the role that Morocco can play in moving forward with the negotiations with regard to the Israeli-Palestinian issue, especially that Morocco hangs on to its position of two-state solution and the right of the Palestinians to have a free, independent state with Jerusalem as its capital. Thank you.
Thank you very much. First, I was just in Israel before the meeting that we had together in the Negev. I was in Jerusalem and also in Ramallah. And one of the points that I made in both Jerusalem with Israeli counterparts and Ramallah, President Abbas, of course, the United States, continued ongoing support for a two-state solution, an outcome that would meet the aspirations of Palestinian people. Their entitlement to a state of their own, as well as, of course, ensuring the security of Israel and its strength as a Jewish and democratic state. The normalization agreements and the work that Morocco and other countries are doing with Israel is not a substitute for this, this outcome for two states, but it can, I believe, reinforce it. In our discussions yesterday in the Negev, all of the partners in this enterprise, including Morocco, including the United States, talked about the need to advance that that prospect and that horizon. But in the meantime, to do concrete things to help improve the lives of Palestinians. And this is exactly one of the things that the work we're doing through the partnership that now exists among the countries that participated in the Negev Summit, that's exactly one of the things that we're focused on. And we were talking in very concrete ways about initiatives that we can undertake together to improve the lives of the Palestinian people. At the same time, I think that Morocco's growing relationship with Israel, as well as that of other countries, will further strengthen its voice, as well as our own voice, in trying to advance the prospect of two states and improving the lives of Palestinians day in, day out.
Our first question will go to Connor Finnegan, ABC News.
Thank you. Mr. Foreign Minister, on the Abraham Accords, the previous U.S. administration had pledged to open a consulate in Western Sahara. And yet this administration has so far not taken any steps to follow through on that. Are you concerned that the U.S. will not meet that commitment? And when you reference the Negev Summit, can you be more specific? What kinds of concrete steps is Morocco willing to take to deepen ties with Israel? Mr. Secretary, Russian and Ukrainian delegations met today in Turkey. You have been skeptical of talks with Russia so far during this war, but both sides are now openly discussing the potential terms of an agreement. So yes or no, do you believe that Russia is now engaging in genuine dialogue? The Ukrainian side has also said that any agreement must involve security guarantees by third countries. Will the U.S. get involved in talks, including by providing security guarantees? And the Ukrainian foreign minister specifically warned today to his delegation before the meetings to not eat, drink, or touch anything during the talks. Do you have any comment on the recent reports of potential poisoning? And do you have any concern for the negotiator's safety? Thank you.
With regard to the first part of your question, obviously the three-party agreement is definitely an important document that created dynamics in terms of relations with Israel, but also in terms of promoting relations in different aspects with the U.S. Morocco is definitely confident that Moroccan and U.S. relations are strong, tense, but moving forward in the right direction. We are fully confident that all aspects pertaining to the three-party agreement signed in December 2020 can be applicable as part of agreements and also as part of the timing that different parties deem relevant and appropriate. But the position of the U.S. with regard to the autonomy under Moroccan sovereignty is firm and stable under different administrations, and we have heard that again today. Autonomy under Moroccan sovereignty is the only solution supported by the U.S. and by other countries. And you have also seen recently Spain and Germany joining and other African and Arab countries. They all go along the same direction. So we are all fully confident that positions are moving forward, are continuing. And the implementation of that hinges on different considerations that we can perhaps talk about between us directly. Now, regarding the second part of your question, the Moroccan and Israeli relations are very special. Based on the long and strong relations between the kings of Morocco and the Moroccan Jewish people that consider a big chunk of the Israeli population. This is a part that enriches this relation. Since the signing of the three-party agreement, a number of things have happened since then in terms of visits, agreements, direct airlines, and also different delegations coming in, and also visits of different officials. The next step, as Antony said, should go directly to concrete projects that business people can feel, that citizens can feel and see in both countries. His Majesty talked about a choice based on conviction. It's natural choice. This natural choice based conviction should also be strengthened and fortified by concrete projects, by projects visible to the citizens in agriculture, in use of water, in security, stability, and so on and so forth. So this is what can actually give this relation more strength. 2 weeks ago, we saw a visit of Moroccan business people to Israel, where they had direct meetings with their counterparts. So how can we invest in this economic field so we can sign more agreements on qualified industrial zones? This can be a three-party cooperation area for different parties to generate more opportunities of development for everybody. So this relationship has been moving forward with still a lot of opportunities in the future.
Connor, thank you. First on the talks, I would leave it to our Ukrainian partners to characterize whether there is any genuine progress and whether Russia is engaging meaningfully. What I can say is this. There is what Russia says, and there is what Russia does. We're focused on the latter. And what Russia is doing is the continued brutalization of Ukraine and its people. And that continues as we speak. As a result of this aggression committed by Russia, as I mentioned the other day, fully half of the children in Ukraine have been displaced from their homes. Half of the children. And of course, we've seen what is going on in Mariupol among other places. So we're focused on what Russia does. And what it should do is end the aggression now. Stop firing. Pull its forces back. And of course, engage in talks. The fact that the Ukrainians have the extraordinary courage and willingness and determination not only to stand up for their country and their futures, but to engage in these talks with a gun literally to their head, I think speaks volumes. But I would look to them to characterize whether there's anything meaningfully coming. If there is some kind of outcome And if our support for Ukraine can be part of that outcome, including our support in the future for its defense and security, of course, that's something we'll want to pursue. But again, from what I have not seen anything that suggests that this is moving forward in an effective way, because Russia, at least we've not seen signs of real seriousness. But if Ukraine concludes that there is, that's good, and we support that. As to the stories about poisoning, I don't have any details on that. I've seen the reports. What I can say is that, of course, this raises concerns because Russia has a real track record. And you only have to go as far back as the poisonings in the UK, Navalny, and others to see why concerns would certainly be understandable.
Shekel, I owe it 360.
Ma question s'adresse aux deux ministres.
My question is for the two ministers. The United Kingdom is organizing in Marrakesh a summit for Africa. How could Morocco become a platform to further develop this relationship with African countries?
As I said, our relations have regional ramifications. What we are doing in our bilateral relations is productive and beneficial to our two countries, to our two peoples, to our two economies. But this also has got other repercussions regionally in terms of the economic effects. You know how much His Majesty hangs on to Africa to achieve stability there and development. Africa is not a burden now for the international community. It's an opportunity for the international community. There are many opportunities and big potentials in Africa. Africa has proven, even during COVID, some kind of resilience before the economic effects of the pandemic. Africa, its clout lies in its young population. It is the only part of the world where you have 30 million individuals that on an annual basis join the middle class. This is unprecedented. It's not seen in other parts of the world. This is by itself and itself an economic potential. Africa has got a lot of potential of infrastructures, renewable resources, technologies, and so on and so forth. Africa is an opportunity. That's why Morocco has developed its relations thanks to the vision with Africa, thanks to the vision of His Majesty the King. Morocco is heavily present in Africa. It's the second investor, African investor in Africa. So how can we cooperate with our American partners? We are the only ones having an FTA with the U.S. in Africa. Africa now is creating this Zleka. Free trade agreement in Africa. So how can we use our bilateral FTA as a platform to get to Africa jointly? We have a joint vision on development and stability and prosperity in Africa. So how can a U.S. businessman from Morocco or based on a partnership with Morocco can actually expand into Africa, especially in its western part and central part? All these are potentials that we need to talk about within this forum to be held in July. This is the vocation of Morocco, to be a bridge between partners and Africa. That's what we're going to do in this economic forum in July.
I would add simply that I think that when we had a long conversation about this, actually, just today, about how we can work to get people to determine their own future, not to have Russia or anyone else determine it for them. And so I think that will continue to be expressed one way or another in all parts of the country. With regard to my meeting later today with the conference, it's fortuitous that we have this opportunity to take advantage of our presence here, to spend some time together. I'm very much looking forward to it. We'll have an opportunity to have a truly strategic conversation about the whole range of issues that we're working on together, regionally, internet, globally. And I'll have more to say, no doubt, about that tomorrow. But this is an important strategic relationship and partnership with the United States. I'm really pleased to have the chance to sit down with him. I was with the foreign minister for the last more than 24 hours in the Negev. We had an opportunity to spend some time together. And, of course, we're working very closely together, not only in the context of the Negev summit, but on so many other issues. So more to say about that tomorrow, but I'm looking forward to it.
Question is Spain. Of course, the letter of the Prime Minister of Spain to His Majesty expressing support to the Moroccan autonomy plan as the basis for any solution to the Sahara issue is a very positive development. And we reacted and we welcome that this development, and we consider that it is, as His Majesty said, it will open a new chapter in our bilateral relations. The position of Spain is not an isolated one. There is a dynamic at the international level in support of the Moroccan autonomy plan as a serious, credible outcome for this regional dispute. This is the position of the United States. This is the position of Germany. This is the position of France. This is the position of the Arab countries. This is the position of the African countries and others. So that's why we think it's time for Europe mainly, and I said that before, to get out of this comfort zone where people are just supporting a process. And supporting a process doesn't mean supporting a solution. You can be comfortable in saying, yes, we support a process, and this process could last for decades. What is important now, and why there is this dynamic, and the Mistura is also part of this dynamic, is how to shift into an outcome-oriented effort. And in this regard, in different areas of the world, there is a consensus that this solution should be within Moroccan sovereignty and within the Moroccan autonomy. And we hope that other countries will follow to get out of this comfort zone and to be active in finding a solution instead of being passive in supporting the status quo. On Ukraine, Moroccan position is very clear, and it has been expressed many times. We are in favor of territorial integrity and national unity of Ukraine as all the member states of the United Nations. We are against the use and the recourse to force in settling disputes. We are in favor of constructive neighborhood relations, and we are in favor of dialogue and negotiation to solve issues. This has been our position. It is clear. And it is in line with the UN Charter. It is in line with the principles of international law in which we believe. So this position has been expressed, and we have to learn the opportunity to discuss more details about that. Thank you.